comment, this is not based on research. When Tushar talked to me about it and I asked, well, do you really want me to come and help you on my hands? And he laughed loudly. And then Avinash called me up and said, you know, you have vast experience of dealing with farmers, why don't you come and talk? I have none. So I thought that was another invitation to wave my hands, which I'm going to do now. Okay, so it is kind of provocative thoughts. We will not present a summary immediately because that will be really provoking. We'll go come back to the summary at the end. Let's clarify the terms. Prosperous or just not hungry. A point we have been covered. So I don't need to elaborate on that. I mean, what is the term prosperity that we are using? We're just talking about people who are not hungry. That's about all. So let's not do. Now this, however, this business of small farmer prosperity is something that with which I've been engaged for more than a decade now. In 2000 or thereabout, when I just joined the board of ID, when Tushar was the chairman of ID, Paul Pola was the chairman who set up the ID, talked about making small farmers exit poverty trap by enabling them to produce $1 per square meter of land, which works out to $10,000 per hectare. Alright? Now, I was extremely skeptical about it. What do you say? I mean, because I had done some statistical analysis data at that district level, Kota, Kota, just district at that time, I think it was in 1991 or thereabout, they were making something like, you know, 80,000 rupees and a hectare. And Paul Pola, assuming rupee was that time, 44 rupees to a dollar or whatever. No, so Paul was talking about something like that income in order to make small farmers exit the poverty trap. So I was very skeptical. This just cannot happen. Then it so happened that when kept traveling all over the country and then here and there and of all the places, 30 kilometers away from Ballyguda and Kendamal district, I found producer farmers getting 40 cents per square meter of land. Yeah, it's possible. In Bharuch I found, in Kandamal I found, in Assam I found. So then my skepticism somewhat declined. And now, the 28th case study that Sajid presented, average is 80,000 rupees, 79,000 rupees per acre. That will translate to 40 cents, you know, just about that. So it is possible. No, from 40 cents to 100 cents looks like a makeable leap, not from 10 cents to $1. Yeah? Yeah. No, for the main land farmer, the farming is a matter of choice. Let's understand that. That's why I am talking from the rank's point of view. Remember in Krishna Bhairava, in 1959 or 61 or whatever, she wrote that the lonely fellow book, she talks about rationality as seen as profit maximization being too broad a brush to paint every farmer with. Alright? Therefore, my question is, does every farmer want to be a prosperous farmer? I mean, you may want to be prosperous, that's a different matter altogether. But do you want me to be a prosperous farmer? Then how we know it? I mean, Amrita's work, several years back when I was here in Adini and many other people's work, people are withdrawing from agriculture, retaining them. Centralization is happening and people are getting out. So they want to be prosperous, but they don't want to be prosperous farmers. Alright, there is a distinction between the two. So as far as therefore, the question is there a sociology of agricultural admission? So under what conditions and who feels like making money by putting his hands in soil, night soil and mud? There must be some mindset, some sociology. That is something of which I would like to get my hand on. Now I don't think I have that handy, but I would like to look at it. What are we asking? Are we asking that small farmers can become prosperous? Or are we asking how people condemned to remaining farming can become prosperous? What? Let's distinguish between these two. Because getting out of agriculture is very common, withdrawing is very common. No farmer says that my sons will remain in farming. Matter of fact, when in some organizations or other team, people had some fight with the boss and he said, I said, Achari, I said, nahi juga, kuch nahi ke tumhe to ke kheti karu. And if that year works for me, I will go on to farming. That's our urban people's view of farming. And are we therefore saying, that we want them to be prosperous? Or are we saying, now that you are condemned to remain in farming, would you like to become prosperous? What is the question we are asking? Okay? Now, and how will the ultra-poor fear? That was the mainland farmer question. But much of my life I keep working with tribal people and people in all regions and, you know, remote regions as very questions who come back. At the bottom of the rural pyramid, the question is of survival, not of prosperity. Let's face it. It's of survival. In fact, Maharaj will be talking to you. Whole of Pradhan prides on working with people who do not produce more than 6 months food for themselves. That, at that level, that is their clientele. And Pradhan and organization like that is my clientele. So we are concerned with people who are at the edge of survival. profitability for these farmers is an issue. Let's understand, there are a bit of an issue there. Okay? Now, Dinan Bandhu Karam Karu is this delegate for that. Had this lovely, and we keep using that when we teach family transition, where at the very rock bottom of the transition, beginning of the transition, is a farmer who is resigned to his fate. Bhagwan ji mere liye kuch nahi kar sakta, nothing can happen in my life. So he is going to try. Now from that level of a farmer to somebody who is now earning $1 per square meter, a bit of a transition, you will agree. And you need to make that, you need to allow them to make that transition. And therefore, the question which I am asking is twofold question. How do we inject a sense of dissatisfaction among possibly complacent and resigned farmers, so that they will want to become prosperous? Number one, that's the first question. How do we make them feel dissatisfied with what they are? Otherwise they are complacent, otherwise they are in the feeling that mere saath to kuch nahi ho sakta, nothing can happen in my life. From that, introduce, inject a sense of dissatisfaction, and having done that, then to enable them to become prosperous. So that's a two-fold question which I am talking about. So for this question, what is more important, the brush or the canvas? Agriculture policy, government, stocking, the God knows what. All this is the canvas. For an ant, that's a big canvas. The ant cannot affect the canvas. Or the brush. Whatever you are doing. To me, the brush is much more important. Therefore, I'm going to look at the changing, the thinking and the standard operating procedures of the farmers. That I think is, if I'm to enable people, then I need to change the thinking, I need to change the SOPs or operations. Obviously, the necessary conditions which everybody has been talking about, he needs to have water control, he needs to work year round, and the reliance on family labor. That's what has come to all the 3 points. Okay, so these are the minimum 3 conditions. Now, everybody has talked about spatial, temporal, activity, product diversification. Spatial, across space, and so on. But I don't have to explain these terms. Now, the question is, what is the qualitative difference? Now, this is what I used to teach when I used to teach farmers and rural economics to my students here at Edma, that risk, rainfall agriculture farmer exposed to risk, diversify. Therefore, I raise this question here, what is the qualitative difference between diversification for risk reduction and diversification for prosperity? And can we get a handle on that? Please remember, I am asking questions, don't ask me to reply to this question. I know the answer as of now. Hopefully, if I can continue to engage with this question, maybe some answers will emerge over a period of time. At the moment, I have no answer. But is there a qualitative difference between diversification for risk reduction alone and diversification for prosperity? Low risk, high return. That's what Sachin was talking about. Income maximization, wide risk minimization. Is there a new point on the risk efficiency field which the farmers have discovered, which professors like me did not know? Apparently they do. So we probably had considered us to be knowers and farmers are going way ahead of us. So they are probably restoring a low risk, high return point. Now, the aggregation, commodification is prosperity. The prosperity mantra, which seems to be appearing from the points which people have made. You know, you are doing my first director, Mr. Andy, would always be when I have entered his office. So I have splashed so much water on his table that he never will be. Thank you. Now, prosperity mantra is small lots, many products, multiple varieties, repeated harvesting, multiple harvesting is what you are talking about, and direct marketing to consumers. That's the prosperity mantra. If people can do it, chances are they will become prosperous. That's why I call it the mantra. In fact, one NGO which has supported, now my trust supports in Nashik district called Yuva Mitra, Sunil Pote is the secretary of that. The condition for joining the NGO's work is that you will grow nothing on more than 5 guthas. 1/8 of an acre. No single crop on more than 1/8 of an acre. Of course, he is close to Nashik and therefore he can get directly, his farmers can market directly. It is logic, it's simple. If somebody puts entire land into tomato, arithmetic is simple. He's going to make a 5 lakh rupee acre loss. That's his logic, okay? I never explored that logic fully. But maybe he got tied up with Pepsi for tomato production or whatever, you know. That's all. Now, the question is this mantra forced on them by the market structure. If it inherits in the very nature of an agricultural economy dominated by small herders and facing growing urban market. I think that's where the trick is probably. The bigger smallholder agriculture and the market, I mean market for simple things, not for war or for stevia or for vanilla or for sufferin pussy or things like that. I'm talking about simple commodities. That market for those simple commodities is the market of growing, paying urban large numbers, not 250 million, God knows, McKinsey got that number from somewhere, but probably it is about 300 million middle class, all willing to pay. So market is large on one side and smallholders are dominating the agriculture. So is this what is becoming that prosperity mantra? I don't know, again I am asking that question. Do agribusinesses have to reinvent themselves in small farmers and to become prosperous? Agribusiness will survive on portions of soybean in the middle of that one factory, logistical efficiencies, you know, so that transportation cost per ton of soybean is minimized and things like that. Here what does this ant say? Multiple crops, small lots, multiple varieties, different sowing dates. So no uniformity, no bulking possible, no aggregation possible. So the interest of agribusiness and interest of the smallholder prosperity appear to me pulling in different directions. Is that so necessarily? Or is that so in some cases but not so in some other cases? Is that so in some regions but not in some regions? I don't want to be dogmatic about it. Somebody just talked about potato, integrated potato production also reaching prosperity and so on. But we'd like to see more evidence about more regions, more farmers, etc. before saying that this is the dogma. Now, obviously simple question to share also asked. Prosperity at the price of public exchequer or prosperity through a market? Which will be more doable? We play the dairy card, overplay the dairy card. Are you aware that somebody is paying the bill for a glut in the dairy market as of now? As of now. Cooperative dairies in Gujarat are holding huge stocks of powder and butter. And yet, the chairman, encouraged by their constituency related logic, are not willing to reduce the producer prices. So it's a kind of bubble, maybe. Many commodities would have that bubble. And so do you want a prosperity based on that or prosperity based on something which will go on, durable? Alright? So the prosperity of SFPF mantra is the only way out if these are the farmers who are not Sharad Pawar's cousins. If they have no lobbying power, they have no connections, they have to survive on Indian markets, then this is the mantra which they have used. Of course, if they have a Sharad Pawar backing them with blocking imports and things like that, well, maybe they could use another mantra. But the small farmers with whom we take to deal have no such lobbying power and no such connections. In which case the question arises, how many small farmers can be prosperous? So I just tend to small field markets. I mean somebody, Sachin was talking about exotic vegetables. He produces broccoli, let us say in Nashik. How many people are going to buy broccoli in Nashik? So there are five farmers producing that, maybe the market is saturated, the prices will. Wow. There are very thin markets. A large number of markets are thin, so now we need additional. You need to produce multiple varieties, multiple crops, but of products which are reasonably deep markets, not thin markets. Additional condition coming into picture. Therefore, this is the Ismaili farmers who were told by His Highness to migrate from Saurashtra into Yavatmal. I went and bought some land, something that was solid and prosperous in Yavatmal, but diversifying the market. Instead of just sending it to Yavatmal or to Nagpur or to Chandrapur market, they send it to 20 different markets. Mobile is a beautiful thing, you can keep calling everybody, getting to know the prices, sending it and so on and so forth. Therefore, a simple hypothesis. That the small farmer also will need to be nimble if he wants to be prosperous. What do I mean by nimble? He can't put everything in the sugar cane which will take 10 months to grow. That will not be nimble. He'll have to grow, therefore the multiple varieties, different growing dates, and so on and so forth. He'll have to be nimble. He'll have to figure out what is demanded on this day. He'll have to kind of back calculate that when it is coming and make that. So if you miss it by a week, it's gone. That flour, instead of fetching 100 rupees a kilogram on Dashara day, will fetch 10 rupees a kilo. So you have to be nimble. Very, very market sensitive. And does multiple diversification aid in becoming nimble? Or does it Does being nimble mindset allow multiple diversification? Another question. I don't know which comes first, and I would like to explore this and see where we go from here. So therefore, let me just come to my summary. And this summary of the ants view. As an ant, what will I tell the small farmer? First thing, if you can learn some skills, migrate to the city, work your way up. That's far more secure way of achieving reasonable security. Don't be very far. Where there's no security at all, you suddenly have no guarantee of becoming prosperous. If you have to, then follow my small prosperity mantra. A small lot, multiple crops, multiple varieties, multiple harvests and direct marketing. If you can do it, good. If some girl person that comes and talks to you about organic food, stevia, vanilla, this, that and the other, pet stone, that's even throw him out. Because the moment when we did this study, Cornell did this study for us for some producers in Vidarbha. Whenever the international prices turn favorable, it takes 2 weeks for the traders to adjust the domestic prices. But the international prices turn unfavorable within an hour. So if there is a glut in the market or anything like that, the so-called agribusiness trader melts away faster than mist in the summer morning. Okay? So don't trust them at all. So if some people come and talk to you, play to flow or what, flow to play and so on, don't believe it. Follow this large Indian domestic market which demands simple things, you know, waiting, wagon, those kinds of things. Sell them multiple lots, but follow the multiple ones. If you still want to grow a single harvest cash crop with lots of inputs, cultivate the test for an endosulfan and organophosphate. Because you may need it to end it all if this doesn't work. Thank you.